One of the things that came up in the discussions after your presentation was a quote by Vonnegut, and he's discussing, it's from the Playboy interview he gave, and he's discussing his views on Darwin. He says, I'm not very grateful for Darwin, though I suspect he was right. His ideas make people crueler. Darwinism says to them that people who get sick deserve to be sick, that people who are in trouble must deserve to be in trouble. When anybody dies, cruel Darwinists imagine we're obviously improving ourselves in some way. And the man who's on top is there because he's a superior animal. That's the social Darwinism of the last century, and it continues to boom.
Mm.
So one of
very,
the...
Very good quote by Vonnegut. Very good.
Yeah. So one of the issues that was discussed was, why is this ambivalence with Vonnegut? Why is he ambivalent about Darwinism? And on one hand, he's very convinced Darwinist. And on the other hand, he's not so crazy about it. So there's some sort of ambivalence in there. I don't know if you have any comments.
Yeah, like at first, on the physical level, or Darwin's explanation of the biological level, Vonnegut's intrigued. Because, you know, Vonnegut studied as a scientist first, as a chemist. He's drawn into that science of Darwin. And, you know, he has no other way of explaining the biological level other than Darwin. So he's like, yes, I think this is a very good description, or the best we've got. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, he doesn't realize, I think, that Darwin's ideas are based on materialism. Like, Darwin is a scientific materialism, since he borrowed his idea of natural selection from Adam Smith.
Yeah.
Okay? And he took Adam's idea of economism and transferred to nature. And that's pointed out by Stephen Jay Gould in a couple of his books. And so when Darwin is borrowing this materialism, underlying Vonnegut can sense that there's something I like about this, but there's something I don't like about it, and that's the implications of materialism on culture, which he investigates in Breakfast of Champions.
So basically, his objections to evolution are not on the scientific level. He's not criticizing evolution on the scientific level, saying there are scientific problems with it. It's more on the moral level. When you apply Darwin to society, then the outcome is not something that he feels okay with, basically.
Yeah, in general, yes. It's kind of interesting, or ironic, because usually Vonnegut is a person who attacks science and technology, and in this case, he's embracing Darwin's science. But the technology that he's always been very critical of is based there. But I guess it's difficult to see through all that technology to look at the materialistic ideology behind. But yeah, the ambivalence comes out of that because there's an implication to that belief system of materialism.
Yeah.
And Vonnegut is seeing that come out as cruel Darwinism.
Yeah.
You know, as some people would say, social Darwinism.
Mm-hmm.
But he notice with Vonnegut's quotation here, he doesn't connect cruel Darwinism to the Nazis. He's connecting cruel Darwinism to American economics.
Yeah, military, yeah. And stuff like that.
And power and greed. Yeah. You know, so there's quite a difference here.
Yeah. One thing I've noticed, I get the impression that there are other people like Vonnegut that have the same ambivalence, and I'm thinking of Vonnegut's friend Stephen Jay Gould, who's the one well-known biologist, paleontologist rather, and a very, very ardent evolutionist as well. And I get the impression that he also noticed that this same logic could develop, and I think that to get out of this dilemma, I think this is one of the reasons why he developed his concept of non-overlapping magisteria, noma, his noma concept, which basically says that science has an authority and basically an authority in the realm of the empirical, but when we're dealing with moral issues, then it's appropriate to refer to religion. So religion has its magisteria or its authority, and science has its own when it's talking about the material world. And obviously he would agree with Vonnegut that Darwin had the right answers for the explaining the biological world especially. But so this is something paradoxical. Here we find people who are very convinced evolutionists, very ardent evolutionists, and yet when they're saying, when we're talking about evolution as applied to the human world, the social world, then suddenly they're saying, no, we shouldn't be applying this. And it's sort of strange that we also find this in another very ardent evolutionist, as well known as Richard Dawkins. In an Australian Broadcasting Network interview, he says, there have been, in the past, attempts to base a morality on evolution. I don't want it to have anything to do with that. The kind of world that a Darwinian, going back to survival of the fittest now, and nature red in tooth and claw, I think nature really is red in tooth and claw. I think if you look out at the way the wild nature is out there in the bush and the prairie, it is extremely ruthless and extremely unpleasant. It's exactly the kind of world that I would not wish to live in. And so any kind of politics that is based upon Darwinism for me would be bad politics. It would be immoral. Or putting it another way, I'm a passionate Darwinian when it comes to science, and when it comes to explaining the world, I'm a passionate anti-Darwinian when it comes to morality and politics. Now this is a bit strange. Now why would a passionate or coherent Darwinist feel this way? Why should a scholar and a devoted evolutionist like Dawkins make such an opinion? There's something strange going on here. Now, I get the impression certain marketing issues are part of the picture. If you're attempting to promote evolution as a cosmology, and these are instances where Darwinism, as applied to the real society, have ended up as cases of being very bad publicity. So these claims about Darwinism being abused quickly appear on the lips of the apostles of Darwin. And another tack is to arbitrarily demand that Darwin not be applied to real societies. But this raises the question, why not? Wouldn't it be more coherent if one is a convinced Darwinist, one who is convinced that Darwin is really true, than to apply Darwin simply to real societies? So these disclaimers that we encounter either in Vonnegut or in Stephen Jay Gould or in Dawkins seem to indicate that these individuals, in some sense, don't really believe Darwin to be true as much as they say. They obviously want him to be true, and this is an interesting question in its own right. But if Darwin is really true, then there seem to be certain unpalatable consequences. So, but why should one stop being coherent with one's cosmology for such a reason?